Everyone, it's good to be gathered again today to worship the Lord together. A few announcements before we begin. Do stick around if you're able to. After the morning service, we'll have a time of snacks and fellowship together, as well as Sunday school, where we continue to look at the Belgic Confession. Then the Spanish worship service is at 6 p.m. today, and all are welcome. Also keep Reverend Del Puche in your prayers. He is away in Modesto this morning preaching at Trinity Reformed Church there and hoping to be back this evening, as also am I hoping that he will be back this evening, because we do have a Spanish worship service at 6 p.m. today as well, so we'd like him to be back for that for sure. Do notice that the VBS program that he's running continues on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 10 a.m. to noon, particularly for younger children. So if you'd like to come out and help with that or have any younger children to bring, do keep that in mind. Throughout the week, we also have a couple of activities. Thursday, the 5th, July 5th, we have our regularly scheduled Bible study at 7 p.m. in the evening. And study guides for that are on the back table. And then ladies, do particularly take note. You're supposed to RSVP to Shanna Williams by this Saturday, July the 7th, if you're going to be able to attend the ladies' tea in Tehachapi on July 21st. So although the event is still a few weeks away, your RSVP deadline is sneaking up on you quickly. So please do bear that in mind. And then next week, we will be celebrating the Lord's Table during our morning worship service, so please make your plans to attend for that. And also, just a reminder, the normal practice here is that if you're going to partake of the Lord's Table, you put your name down on a card, and the cards can be found on the back, or somebody can bring them to you, or we can put some up front here as well. And that's just how we keep a record of the participation in the Lord's Table. And we've noticed recently that not everyone remembers to fill out a card. So this is just your friendly reminder. When you come in on a communion Sunday, please write your name down on one of those cards so we can have an accurate record. And you're not depending on my memory of who was here and who was not here. And then next week also, our worship service will be followed by a fellowship meal. So there won't be any Sunday school, but please do bring a dish to share instead. And stick around after that, and the theme on that is All-American Picnic. In your bulletin then, there's also a reminder about the Lord's Supper and a little paragraph you can read there to prepare your heart for that as we come next week. We do want to come to that with hearts prepared, ready to receive God's grace through this additional means as well. Not only is the preaching of the word a means of grace, but so are sacraments, so we want to come prepared to maximize the benefit that we'll receive there. Well, I think those are all the announcements I need to make just at this moment, so let's take a moment to prepare our hearts for worship by listening to the prelude, which will be followed by a moment of silent prayer. Thank you. worship the Lord together. I'll invite you all to rise for our call to worship taken today from Psalm 117. Praise the Lord, all you Gentiles. Laud him, all you peoples. For his merciful kindness is great toward us, and the truth of the Lord endures forever. Praise the Lord. That is our authority, that is our warrant to come and to worship the Lord today. And as we do so, we're encouraged by his wonderful words of welcome to us and the words of the apostolic greeting, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's sing together the words of the Gloria Patri, which are found in your bulletin. You continue steadfast in your loving kindness, faithful in your truth towards us. And so we ask that today you would enable us to praise you as we should. May our hearts be filled with joy and with thanksgiving as we remember what great things the Lord has done for our souls. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We'll remain standing now to sing hymn number 50. If you'll turn in your blue Trinity hymnals to hymn number 50, and we'll remain standing to sing all the stanzas. our service where we profess our faith together, where we review what it is that we believe, which we'll do first of all this morning by means of the Apostles' Creed, which you can find on the back of your bulletin. Child of God, what is it that you believe? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen indeed. What a great comfort it is to go over those essential parts of our faith and be reminded again that behind all of the ups and downs of this life, all of the discouragements and trials of our lives, there stands this tremendous reality of the triune God who has promised us, who communicates to us the forgiveness of sins and the life everlasting. When you look at it in those lights, really, we don't have that much to complain about, do we? We come now then to the Heidelberg Catechism, Lord's Day 26, which you can find on page 78 of your green catechism booklet. Here it's continuing to talk about the sacraments, and today we come to the first Lord's Day that's devoted to the subject of baptism. And since the Lord Jesus only instituted two sacraments for his church, clearly they're both of tremendous importance, and it's to our advantage to review, to come back again and again to what it is that these things mean. And so I'll read the questions and we'll recite the answers together. Heidelberg Catechism, Lord's Day 26, question 69. How is it signified and sealed unto thee in holy baptism, that thou hast part in the one sacrifice of Christ on the cross? Thus, that Christ instituted this outward washing with water, and joined therewith this promise, that I am washed with his blood and spirit from the pollution of my soul, that is, from all my sins, as certainly as I am washed outwardly with water, whereby commonly the filthiness of the body is taken away. And question 70, what is it to be washed with the blood and spirit of Christ? It is to have the forgiveness of sins from God through grace for the sake of Christ's blood, which he shed for us in his sacrifice on the cross, and also to be renewed by the Holy Spirit and sanctified to be members of Christ, that so we may more and more die unto sin and the holy and unblameable lives. And finally, question 71. Where has Christ promised that we are as certainly washed with his blood and spirit as with the water of baptism? In the institution of baptism, which says, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. This promise is also repeated where Scripture calls baptism the washing of regeneration and the washing away of sins. In this whole teaching about baptism from the Heidelberg Catechism, there's a repeated emphasis on what is called the double benefit of Christ. You have that very clearly in question 70. What does it mean to be washed with the blood and spirit of Christ? Well, on the one hand, it's to be washed with his blood from the guilt of our sins, to have the forgiveness of sins from God through grace for the sake of Christ's blood. But more than that, salvation is not just freedom from guilt and from condemnation. It includes that. But it's more than that as well. It's also to be renewed by the Holy Spirit. In other words, we're cleansed not just from the guilt of sin, we're cleansed also from the power or the pollution of sin. We're freed from sin as a force that condemns us. We're freed also from sin as a force that corrupts and enslaves us. And we give praise to God for this double cure of the double problem of sin, because it would be misery to be left with only one half of that salvation. But baptism speaks to us of both. We are freed from guilt. We are freed also from contamination. Thanks be to God for that tremendous blessing. Now today we have, in addition to the ordinary elements, also a reading from the Psalter, and we have selected readings in the back of the hymnal. So if you turn in the back of the Trinity hymnal, there's pages that are numbered down at the bottom, and we're looking for page 610, where we have Psalter Selection 6, and this is specifically drawn from Psalm 18. And the standard procedure here is that I'll read the non-bolded portions, and the congregation reads the bolded portions in unison. So, Psalter Selection 6, taken from Psalm 18, on page 610 of your Trinity hymnals. Let's hear God's word together now. I will love thee, O Lord, my strength.
The Lord is my rock and my fortress.
I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from mine enemies.
The stars of the dead are my strength, and the floods of ungodly men invade
me. The sorrows of hell compassed me about. The snares of death confronted me.
In my distress, I called upon the Lord, and cried unto my God. He heard my voice out of his temple, and my cry came before him.
Then the earth shook and trembled. The foundations also of the hills moved and were shaken because he was wroth.
There was smoke out of his nostrils, and fire out of his mouth devoured.
He bowed the heavens also and came down, and darkness was under his feet.
And he rode upon the chariot
He made darkness his secret place, his pavilion round about him were dark waters and thick clouds of the skies.
And the brightness that was before him was thick clouds fast, veils from the poles of
the Lord also thundered in the heavens, and the highest gave his voice, hailstones and coals of fire.
Yea, he sent out his arrows and scattered them, and he shot out lightnings.
Then the channels of waters were seen, and the foundations of the world were discovered at thy rebuke, O Lord, at the blast of the breath of thy nostrils.
He sent from above, he delivered me.
He delivered me from my strong enemy and from them which hated me, for they were too strong for me. He brought me forth also into a large place. He delivered me because he delighted in me. Amen. Let our reading of God's word there. Let's come before the Lord in prayer now. Let's all pray. Our gracious God and loving Heavenly Father, it is our joy and our privilege to heed and to answer your call to worship. It is our delight to gather together to receive the means of grace this day. Lord, we are mindful of the fact that we do not deserve the least of these blessings, that by our conduct we have certainly not earned them, but that on the contrary you have been pleased in great grace and mercy to pour out so many blessings richly upon us. Lord, we are constrained to confess also that very often we are ungrateful. We receive your blessings and we take them as a matter of course. We take them as something owed to us. Perhaps even worse, we are unmindful of them altogether. We don't see that you have sustained us in life. We don't see that you have granted us many blessings, both for this life and especially for the life to come. So, Lord, we humbly beseech your forgiveness, that you would still be patient with us, that you would overlook our overlooking of your grace, and that you would help us, O Lord, with meek, humble, and thankful hearts to receive the tremendous blessings that you have for us. Lord, we acknowledge that often when we are discontented, it is because we have lost sight of what great things you have done for us in Christ. And so we pray that you would make our time together today in your word to be helpful, profitable to us in this regard. May we receive that adjustment of soul that we need so much as we're called back to remember the great truths of your word. May it indeed serve to make us more humble and also more thankful, and thus more abundant also in good works. Father, we do give you praise for those who are able to be here this morning, and we pray that you would minister to the need of everyone. Lord, we know there are several who are gone by reason of travel out of town. We pray that you would meet with them and encourage them. We pray that they too would know your grace and favor this day. And Lord, we know that many are under the weather and struggling today. Think of Mary Ann, Dolly Kirschman. We pray for Landon also, Lord, who was sick this week. And we ask that you would be pleased to grant comfort and relief. Lord, we do remember our sister Dolly particularly. You know how many trials she has faced in recent days. We give you praise for the grace that you have given her to face them calmly, to overcome in the name of the Lord. And Father, we pray that you would grant her relief from the flare-up of pain that she's been experiencing. We ask that you would watch over and preserve her in this time of difficulty, that she would know your tender love, and oh Lord, that even the multitude, the difficulty, the length of these trials would serve to show her more fully how tenderly you care for her, how abundantly sufficient you are to make up for whatever else we lack, and that you would be at work in her, Lord, in this time to draw her near to yourself, to conform her more to the image of Christ. We pray that you would help her to remain mindful of the many reasons that she has for praise and for thanksgiving, and that in this way, O Lord, even out of the midst of pain and suffering, there would be praise to your name from your daughter, whom you have redeemed and to whom you have always been faithful. Lord, we give you thanks that as we pray, Pastor Powell came safely through his surgery. We pray that you would continue to speed his recovery. We pray that the surgery would have been successful in eliminating the cancer with which he was diagnosed, and that you would be pleased to strengthen him also for the shoulder surgery he is to undergo as soon as he's well enough to do so. Oh Lord, we pray that you would bless him and his wife Susan with a return of health and strength, that you would preserve their functionality, their ability to serve you week by week. Lord, we would pray for Pastor Abuche as he's away from us this morning preaching at Trinity Reformed Church in Modesto. We pray that you would grant him the help of your Spirit, that he would be a blessing to the people there, that you would enable him to bring to them, O Lord, just the word that they need to hear, and that his own soul would be encouraged and refreshed by the fellowship with them. We pray that you would bring him safely back to us and equip him with great grace for all of his labors here. We ask, O Lord, that you would strengthen and bless him in all of the different avenues of outreach that he has for Valle de Gracia. And we pray, Lord, that you would be pleased to strengthen that mission work, to build it up. We pray that you would bring in those who have their hearts already prepared to desire the preaching of the word of God, and that you would bring us in contact with them, Lord, that we could be a blessing to them, and that they could be for the strengthening of the mission work as well. Lord, we're mindful of many great needs that we have in this congregation. We pray that you would be pleased to be at work in all of our lives. We ask, despise the preaching of your word, that we would not be indifferent or neglectful with regard to the sacraments. Lord, as we prepare our hearts to come to the Lord's table next week, we pray that you would help us to remember what a wonderful blessing it is to consider seriously how much need we have of grace. And so to come, O Lord, as those who truly are displeased with themselves for their sins, and yet trust that these are forgiven them, that our remaining infirmities are covered because of the work and person of Jesus Christ. And so may we come, O Lord, knowing that we need him, but believing also assured that you are pleased to communicate to us in this way the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is able to build us up, to give us an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. Father, we do pray for the many in our congregation who continue to face challenges in their health. We are so thankful for how you have strengthened and blessed our brother Glenn Handel. We pray that you would be with him. We pray that the season of a short respite from the chemotherapy would be profitable to him. We pray that they would be able to resume the recommended schedule soon. And, O Lord, that in all this back and forth with regard to these matters, that you would keep him in perfect peace, that he would trust you, that he would know that his times are in your care, that he has nothing to fear, that you will be with him at every moment. Lord, we do remember again little Francisco. We pray that you would be with him, that he would begin to thrive in his health, that he would gain the weight that he ought to gain. We pray that you would be with Zane and Jenna as they care for their firstborn child. As having this unusual medical need, we pray that you would be with Tom and Cindy as they seek to encourage and be a blessing to them. Oh Lord, we pray that this time of unusual difficulty would be a time also of unusual grace when they grow, when they know you more fully and serve you more gladly. Father, we are thankful for our sister congregations, and we do pray for St. John's Reformed Church in Lincoln, Nebraska. Thank you for Reverend Lee Johnson and his labors there. We pray, O Lord, that you would strengthen him for this labor, that you would grant to him great wisdom, that you would grant to him patience, that as he studies week by week, his own soul would be encouraged, his faith would be built up, and Lord, that he would have abundant treasures from what you give to him to share with the congregation. We pray that they would be drawn together in unity of faith and hope and love, that working together in this way, the congregation would grow, that you would add to their number, and Lord, that you would enable them to bear faithful witness in that place. We pray that you would bless the work of the gospel there and indeed throughout the world. We pray for the churches with whom we are associated in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. O Lord, add to them, strengthen them, provide pastors for the congregations. Cause your word to continue to grow and to flourish. We pray that you would meet the physical and material needs as well as the spiritual needs of your church in that place. O Lord, we commit into your hands our rulers and governors as well. We pray, O Father, that even when it is not what they are planning, even when it is not the design of their heart, that you would so work in and through them that your church would have peace, that there would be full freedom to preach the word of God without fear of hostility or persecution. And Lord, we pray that you would strengthen and equip your church, that we would not get distracted with side issues, but that we would focus on our mission, that we would make disciples of all nations. And we pray, Lord, that the net result of the work of the governments of this world would be to create a space in which the word of God can be proclaimed to all and sundry. Oh Lord, you know there are many other needs that weigh upon our hearts, many other things for which we could pray. We rejoice in the knowledge that you already know what we have need of, that the Holy Spirit searches our hearts and brings our needs before you more fully, more comprehensively, more exactly than we could even know to do. And so we commit ourselves, all that we are and have, into exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask or think, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Before we come to the preaching of God's word, shall we stand once again to sing number 453, hymn 453, Oh, the Deep, Deep Love of Jesus. Turn in the Word of God today back to the book of Exodus, Exodus chapter 19, and we'll read verses 16 down to verse 25. Exodus 19, beginning with verse 16, let's hear God's Word. Then it came to pass on the third day in the morning that there were thunderings and lightnings and a thick cloud on the mountain, and the sound of the trumpet was very loud, so that all the people who were in the camp trembled. And Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet with God. And they stood at the foot of the mountain. Now Mount Sinai was completely in smoke, because the Lord descended upon it in fire. Its smoke ascended like the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mountain quaked greatly. And when the blast of the trumpet sounded long and became louder and louder, Moses spoke, and God answered him by voice. Then the Lord came down upon Mount Sinai on the top of the mountain. And the Lord called Moses to the top of the mountain, and Moses went up. And the Lord said to Moses, "Go down and warn the people, lest they break through to gaze at the Lord, and many of them perish. Also, let the priests who come near the Lord consecrate themselves, lest the Lord break out against them." But Moses said to the Lord, "The people cannot come up to Mount Sinai, for you warned us, saying, 'Set bounds around the mountain and consecrate it.'" Then the Lord sent him away, "Get down and then come up, you and Aaron with you. But do not let the priests and the people break through to come up to the Lord, lest he break out against them." So Moses went down to the people and spoke to them. We'll end our reading there, and let's ask God's help in a brief word of prayer. Our gracious God and Heavenly Father, we pray that you would help us now to pay attention to your word. May we appreciate what it says. May we receive it with understanding, with the humility of faith. May we embrace it to our hearts, and may we be built up by it. May it serve, O Lord, to remind us of the character of our God and cause us to be humble and yet confidently joyful before him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our text begins by speaking about the third day. Israel had come to Mount Sinai and had undergone 3 days of preparation for meeting God. When God came down on Mount Sinai to meet them, to reveal himself to them, to enter into covenant with them. Now, in the end of chapter 19, we have a part of God's revelation of himself to Israel on this occasion. The other part comes in chapter 20, when God addressed the whole congregation of Israel with an audible voice and addressed to them the Ten Commandments. But we'll have to postpone that part of God's self-revelation to another occasion. The main idea of this first section of God's manifestation of himself to Israel is that God is so great and so holy that his people need a mediator to enter into his presence. God is so holy, so majestic, that without a mediator, we cannot come before him. And we'll consider that in 3 points. The first is the God of burning fire. The Lord descended upon Mount Sinai in fire, we read in verse 18. And so the whole mountain smoked and shook. And as God came down, Moses brought the people of Israel to the foot of Mount Sinai to meet with God. So they went out when the signal was given, and they knew God was approaching because there were thunderings and lightnings, a thick cloud on the mountain, and the sound of the trumpet was very loud. These things are signs of God's presence. When we read from Psalm 18 a little earlier in the service, many of these same signs were repeated when God came down in that occasion as well. The overall effect was something like a powerful storm or a volcanic eruption. But it was more than that, because the trumpet blast tells you that this was not just an atmospheric or a volcanic phenomenon. On the contrary, it was a genuine revelation of God's presence. And in this revelation of God, what particularly stands out are God's majesty and holiness. And of course, these are the attributes of God which most make us realize how much he is to be feared. You see God's majesty from the reaction of the earth itself. When the Lord descended in fire, the whole mountain shook and smoked. Nature itself shakes when God unveils his greatness. So the prophet Nahum would say, The mountains quake before him. The hills melt. The earth heaves at his presence. Yes, the world and all who dwell in it. It shouldn't come as a surprise that the world and its inhabitants quake before the Lord. Of course they do. A mountain that is burning and smoking, a thick cloud with lightning and thunder, an earthquake, all at the same time. These things make quite an impact. And then you have the trumpet. And then you have the sound of God's voice. And then you have the clearly supernatural character of the fire. The people of Israel had no excuse for doubting that God was there. And their reaction when they saw and heard all of this was that they drew back. They trembled with fear. Even Moses, according to the book of Hebrews, responded with fear and trembling. That was to be expected. That was proper. Later on, Moses remembered this moment. He thought about it. And he drew the conclusion, our God is a consuming fire, Deuteronomy 4:24. In his majesty, in his holiness, our God is a consuming fire. If he's a burning fire to the mountains, well, who among us can dwell with everlasting burnings, as the prophet Isaiah asks? No one can be unmoved. No one can stand on their own two feet when God reveals himself. God is so far beyond us that we feel overwhelmed under the weight of his pure and strong and infinite existence. And yet, God has revealed himself in all this majesty, and he still instructs Moses to go back down the mountain and tell the people not to break through the boundaries that have been set around it. You might think that that was completely unnecessary. Moses apparently thought it was unnecessary, because Moses said to the Lord, the people cannot come up to Mount Sinai. You warned us, saying, set bounds around the mountain and consecrate it. The Lord repeats the command, go down and tell them not to break through. Perhaps somebody would want to cross the line in order to look at God from the other side of the thick cloud, without the smoke getting in the way of their vision. But for the people's own protection, that was not allowed, lest many of them perish, according to verse 21. Why would anybody die from breaking through to see the Lord? Well, God himself answers that question later in the book of Exodus, when he says to Moses, you cannot see my face, for man shall not see me and live. The direct vision of God is too much for us. It would destroy us. Even the seraphim cover their faces in God's presence, according to Isaiah's vision in Isaiah chapter 6. And they have never sinned. Well, how much less can we, in our weakness, in our sinfulness, dare to look upon God? To us, he's wrapped in a thick cloud and smoke because his unmitigated glory is too bright for us to withstand. As I said, Moses reminded God that a boundary had already been set. But God still insisted that he go down and warn the people. And he also added this, do not let the priests and the people break through to come up to the Lord. Even the priests must be particularly consecrated, according to verse 22. Why? What was the point of all of this? Well, you see, along with being so infinitely majestic, God is also supremely holy. He's perfectly pure. He's separate from all sin. He's not tolerant of wickedness at all, not even a little bit. And that is a lesson that we cannot learn too often. The people had been taught this in the first part of Exodus 19. We looked at it when we were in that chapter a week or two ago. And yet we need to hear it again. The Lord has to continue to emphasize to them this lesson of his holiness. Sometimes he had to demonstrate it through judgment. Not too much further down the road, two of Aaron's sons offered before the Lord incense that had not been commanded. And fire came out from the Lord and consumed them to teach the lesson that he would be consecrated. He would be honored in those who drew near to him. The Lord is holy. Our God is to be feared. He is strong. He is jealous, majestic, and holy. All of those things are implied when Moses speaks of God as a consuming fire. We can't trifle with God. We can't mess around with him. Our idea of God is inadequate unless it produces reverence and humility. If God to us is just the subject of a joke, if he's just a nice figure up in the sky who makes sure everything turns out okay in the end, then our idea of God is not biblical, not accurate in the least. God is holy. God is a burning fire to us. Before him, we fall on our face as though poleaxed, as though killed. And with Isaiah, we say, woe is me, I am undone. Until we understand that, we've not understood what we need to know about the character of God. But when we understand the majesty and holiness of God, then we'll also understand why there's such a need for a mediator, which is our second point. If God is too much for us in his majesty and his holiness, how are we supposed to enter into covenant with him? How are we supposed to have a relationship with him? Well, the answer is that a mediator can stand between us. And we see Moses acting as a mediator in this chapter. Moses spoke, and God answered him by voice in verse 19. Moses went up the mountain to speak with God and down the mountain to convey God's message to the people. The Lord was on the top of the mountain, and as we saw, the people were assembled at the foot of the mountain. Moses ascends and descends, and so he is between God and the people. That's the central quality of a mediator, that he's in between to allow contact between two separate parties. The people of Israel also recognize their great need for a mediator. We'll come to this, Lord willing, in chapter 20. But once they have heard God's voice announcing the Ten Commandments, their request was that God would only speak with Moses and in that way let them know his will. Their reason for making that request was fear that hearing God's voice would kill them. They recognized that they couldn't withstand God's majesty and holiness. God's voice was too much for them unless it was transmitted through a human being. And the need for a mediator is met by God's provision of a mediator, which is our third point. The Lord knew that his people had this need, and so Moses was there. Moses was equipped to carry on this function. But of course, Moses was there in a temporary, in a provisional way. He was there fundamentally to point towards the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus really is between God and man, because he's both. He's God and man. In his unique person, he united two distinct, complete, and separate natures. Moses was truly human, but he wasn't God, so Moses couldn't be the ideal mediator. But Jesus Christ is just as human as Moses was. At the same time, he is just as much God as the Father or the Holy Spirit. Therefore, the Lord Jesus is the perfect mediator. In fact, he is the only mediator between God and man, according to 1 Timothy 2:5. So Moses' office as mediator looked forward to Christ, a At the same time, Moses' inadequacy highlighted the need for a better mediator. You can see that Moses was not a perfect mediator from the fact that Aaron went with him up the mountain. Later on, Aaron was appointed as Israel's high priest, not Moses. There was a distinction of offices. There was a division of labor that showed that neither of these men were capable of being the genuine or the ultimate mediator. Moses needed Aaron. Aaron needed Moses. But in Christ, all the great offices are joined together. He is at the same time our prophet, our priest, and our king. He is the maximum, the ultimate mediator. Moses' work gave people a shadowy idea of what Christ would do. Christ is the complete reality of mediation between God and man. And that's why Christ's mediation allows us much greater access to God than Moses' mediation did. The book of Hebrews explains that in the Old Testament, entrance into God's presence was quite limited. But now, we have boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus. What he's talking about there is the way the Old Testament tabernacle was set up. You have the court, you have the holy place, you have the holy of holies, the holiest place of all, into that inner sanctum. Only the high priest could enter, only one day a year, only with an elaborate ritual of sacrifices and washings. That was where the Ark of the Covenant was. That was where God's glory manifested itself in the glory cloud. One man, once a year, with an elaborate ritual. Access into the holiest was very restricted. But in Jesus, there's a new and living way. We all have access into the holiest of all, not one day a year, but all the time. Whenever we choose to come, we have this tremendous privilege, and yet we use it so little. But this access has been thrown open. And then in chapter 12, Hebrews goes on to explain this a great deal more fully. In Hebrews 12, beginning with verse 18, we read, "For you have not come to the mountain that could not be touched, that burned with fire, to blackness and darkness and tempest and the sound of a trumpet and the voice of words, so that those who heard it begged that the word should not be spoken to them anymore. For they could not endure what was commanded, and if so much as a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned or shot with an arrow. And so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, 'I am exceedingly afraid and trembling.'" He's talking about what we read in Exodus 19 and what will follow in Exodus 20, when the Lord descended on Mount Sinai in fire. That was how the people responded to God's manifestation of himself. And Hebrews says, that's not where you've come. No, in contrast to that, you have come to Mount Sinai, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and church of the firstborn who are registered in heaven, to God, the judge of all, to the spirits of just men made perfect. And here's the key to all of it: to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaks better things than that of Abel. There's a tremendous contrast between Israel at Mount Sinai and the child of God at the foot of the heavenly Mount Zion, which is where we are today when we meet together for worship. That's where we're coming. That's where we're approaching. So today, here in this place, we have an incomparably greater privilege than Israel enjoyed at Mount Sinai. Yes, they got to feel the ground shaking. Yes, they got to see Mount Sinai in flame and smoke. Oh, but we have something much greater because we come to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant and the blood of sprinkling that speaks better things than that of Abel. Israel's relationship to God was a close relationship. They were at the foot of the mountain. The Lord was at the summit of the mountain. So less than a mile between them. But the relationship also involved a certain distance. The boundaries could not be broken through. Moses' mediation did not allow for an entire nearness. But Christ is greater and better than Moses. By him we have unhindered access to God. In him God is with us. It is ultimately only through Christ's mediation that God's presence doesn't make us melt like the hills in Nahum's prophecy. Our God is a consuming fire. How can we come before him and not be consumed? You remember in Exodus 3, Moses saw that great sight, that unusual sight, a bush that burned and was not consumed. How is that possible when the bush was alight with God's presence and God is a consuming fire? How can we put those things together? Ultimately, it is because of Christ. God is a consuming fire, but in Christ, we approach him and we're not consumed. We're protected, we're sheltered, we're sustained, and yet the reality of God's presence with us is not diminished or toned down in some way. This is at the heart of our confession of faith. Why are we called Christians? Now, I know the catechism answer to that, but I'm going to give you a little bit of a different answer, fully in harmony, but just a little bit different today. Why do we call ourselves Christians? Because Christ is the mediator. Because through him we come to God. We believe what Christ said of himself. I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. We know of no other mediator. We know of no one who can give us this access to God. We know of no other way of being protected from the consuming fire of God's presence except the Lord Jesus Christ. There are no substitutes. There are no alternatives. No one comes to the Father except through me. Well, when we receive those words as true, we're admitting, on the one hand, that we are sinners who are far from God. That's a part of our confession. Why are you called a Christian? Because I know that I'm a sinner in need of salvation. But we're also confessing that Christ brings us back to God in peace. Why are you called a Christian? Because Christ is your mediator. We confess that God's holiness would consume and destroy us apart from Jesus Christ. It is really a dreadful thing to meet God outside of Christ, without Christ. Hebrews can say it. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Apart from Christ, God is the most dreadful thing in existence. The most terrible person, being we could encounter. But in Christ, it's just the opposite. Because outside of Christ, without Christ, God's holiness burns. But when we meet God in Christ, we receive joy and peace instead of panic and shaking. The distance that protected Israel has been abolished, because in Christ there is no condemnation. In Christ, God embraces us to his heart. Now, we need to be very clear about one thing here. This does not mean that God has changed. God has lost absolutely nothing of his majesty or of his holiness. After Hebrews has pointed out the enormous contrast between Israel at the foot of Mount Sinai and the believer today in Jesus. It goes on to add, therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us have grace by which we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. And now notice this particularly, the reason for that. For our God is a consuming fire. Nothing that Jesus has done has changed God's nature as consuming fire. In the New Covenant, as much as in the Old Covenant, that is true. Just as much as at Sinai, in the New Testament, God continues to be a consuming fire. Our intimacy with Him in Christ does not cancel, does not conceal His majesty or holiness. And what this means is that as we confess Christ, our reverence for God can legitimately be no less than that of Moses. We need to have at least the reverence for God that Moses and the Israelites had on this occasion. The reverence, the awe, the acknowledgement of majesty and holiness has not been diminished. Because the majesty and holiness haven't been diminished. But while that's true, it's also true that in Christ, our nearness to God is very much greater. He brings us near. Shall we pray together? Our gracious God and Heavenly Father, we do acknowledge that you are a consuming fire. We acknowledge that we cannot come into your presence. We cannot stand before you in our weakness, limitation, and sin, except through the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh Lord, we would never seek to take that wonderful work of mediation and turn it into an excuse for a lack of reverence, a lack of seriousness, a lack of awe before our majestic and holy God. But we would lay hold upon that mediation to come, to be received and welcomed, to be restored into your favor, and to know a wonderful, blessed reality of God with us because of Jesus Christ. So help us to draw near with boldness, with reverence, with godly fear. Help us not to put these things in a false tension, but to bow and worship, to love and sing and wonder through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, in response to God's word, I'll ask the ushers to come forward to take up the collection. Thank you. I invite you to rise once again as we turn in our hymnals to number 127. 127, let us love and sing and wonder. Lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.